that's our start.
Let's start.
It's on the Walleye Tank website. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to our second Walleye Tank. My name is Steve Ecker. I am a professor of biochemistry and molecular biology at the Mayo Clinic. And I really want to express a complete and honest, open conversation and opportunity here to meet all of those that are interested in being an entrepreneur or are entrepreneur or building a better world. So a couple of minor things. We're actually, not only are we recording this time, we're actually live on YouTube. If you go to the walleyetank.website, there's a phrase from John Denver, so, when you sing, sing good, okay? So when we clap, let's do a great job. And we're hoping to have this continue to build our community. So welcome. I want to start by inviting Leon Clark, chair of research administration, who's been a great supporter for this, to get us started. Leon.
Yeah. Thank you, Steve, and welcome to all of you once again. It's actually great to see all of you in the room on a cold Friday afternoon. Mm-hmm. One of the things that Steve was saying, he asked me, you know, what is your lofty title? I don't really care. And in fact, I think what we're trying to do in terms of building an entrepreneurial ecosystem in Rochester and at Mayo Clinic should not be dependent on our titles. And I think it takes all of us working together, many grassroots efforts to bring this along. I wanted to maybe just say a couple of things on behalf of the research committee about why this is important to us. And I think what you're seeing at Mayo and in Rochester is a slight shift in our focus for our research and innovation. Not that we hadn't always had that as part of our history, but again, the broadened definition, including translation and application at the bedside, but also in the commercial marketplace. So the idea is, how do we get Mayo's ideas into the commercial marketplace so that they support healthcare consumers and patients everywhere. And so these efforts are essentially important. I would also say that this is part of our financial diversification strategy. So if you look at healthcare generally, I think you all recognize that there's a lot of change and uncertainty going on in the healthcare market. I think if we're going to sustain our research activity and our innovation engine at Mayo Clinic, one of the things that we have to think about is income diversification, and one of the ways in which we do that is by commercializing our IP, starting new companies that bring income back, not only to the Mayo Clinic, but to our community. So once again, I'm here just briefly to say thank you for your reference and your interest. We are behind these efforts from a research committee standpoint, and we also say the Mayo Clinic generally are behind efforts to entrepreneurship, commercialization, and economic growth in our community. We're here to help in any way that we can, so some of these ideas will move forward, and we're interested in monitoring your progress. And some of these will participate. Once again, I just wanted to summarize by saying thank you again for your interest. And thank you, Steve, for all of the good work that you're doing helping to promote, I think, the ecosystem that we really need. Thanks.
Okay, I just wanted to say just a couple of things, especially because I was asked after our first event why we're doing this. And I thought we would do it with the same questions that my entrepreneurship students have to answer, which is, what's the problem? What's the solution? Why us? Why now? And how it's a business. I don't know that I understand the last one, but I'll do the rest, okay, for Walleye Tank. Okay, So nearly 75% of our economic growth since World War II is from STEM fields. Let's just start with some basic data. If you actually look at our top innovations, 90% of it came from federal investment. So you think, put those add together, that this economic development should be a great argument for federal support. Okay, so this is this idea, right? This kind of research investment drives economy, makes it work, solves world problems. So unfortunately, this is actually where we are. A few months ago, the White House let the summary that for R&D by the government, we're at a 60-year low, according to GDP, okay? So percentage of GDP. All right, so if you're in healthcare, there's actually another thing that's even worse, which is called E-Room's Law, which is that in the last 60 years, the cost of a new therapeutic has doubled every 9 years. And this line is largely unchanged. And the prediction has always been, when do we go to zero? So this was published a few years ago. The problem is actually been right, and actually it's accelerating. So in 2016, as of a few weeks ago, the number of new chemical entities that are approved by the FDA was half what it was last year. It was only 20. Right? So we're already at a fundamental challenges. Okay, so this is why I think we want things, people are here in this room, Walleye Tank in the process. We need new solutions. And so Walleye Tank and the entrepreneurial community effort is represented by this solution. We need to find our own ways to build and innovate in science and business, where the business model supports the science and vice versa, so that we can make our new solutions. And we have supporters. These are some of the bait shops. So our fish theme. We had the bait shops last time in June. And what we also do is highlight growing businesses. And these were the businesses from June. They were great. You can see all of these on our website on YouTube. Okay. But we also started building a new company, a deliberate process for startups. And this was the idea to pick an important problem, build a world-class team. These are almost all driven by students or residents, so other students, but MD students. Build a pitch, and that was taught in a class, and we've done it twice. And that was done first in here in June, and you'll see the second graduating class today. I also want to answer why here. So I grew up in Illinois, but I was always jealous of the upper Midwest because of some key advantages. This is us, Rochester. But you may not realize that we're within driving distance of three of the top 25 engineering schools in the world. There are very few places, very few geographies in the world that has that. And then if you combine the fact that Rochester is the highest density of physicians in the world. We should be able to solve problems. We should be able to take this wonderful physician hub, combine it with these engineering problems, and start systematically tackling new healthcare issues. There are other issues that can be done, but this is that opportunity. Why us? You may ask, why now? The state and Mayo are investing literally billions of dollars in the Rochester area for the next few years for the goal of doubling the size of Rochester and fundamentally changing how Rochester is under the Destination Medical Center. So this is that maybe once in a lifetime or once in a multi-decade time in an area to really push this. I would also point out that this week President Obama signed the 21st Century Cures Act. It was no new money, let me be clear, but the 21st Century Cures Act had a set of regulatory changes that are almost likely going to happen that deal with the FDA and allow some innovation with public-private partnerships for funding models that are going to happen. So I have no belief that there's going to be any more money, but I do believe that there's going to be the opportunities for how you spend the money, and that public-private partnerships are critical. Okay, I also want to point out that we're in the age of public benefit corporations. There are new therapeutic startups. That's a new funding model. And with the Title III funding for crowdsourcing, I didn't get it done this year, but I promise the next Walleye Tank, the members of the audience will be able to invest in the businesses that you pitched in. And that's called Title III funding. So there's no question that we are in an era where the opportunities are here. We're setting up the infrastructure. Now it's a matter of doing it. Doing it is what I like to teach by doing. So that's the idea. So welcome to Walleye Tank. When we came up with the name idea, the ice fishing edition, it was, you know, in the middle of global warming. I was a little worried. I admit, I was a little worried that it was going to be 60 degrees and balmy in Minnesota in December. So I'm sorry, because I think Mother Nature wanted to prove me right, so I'm sorry for that, but thank you for coming. We have a great lineup today of three junior anglers, 11 companies. Joy from Lifestyle Ledger has had to pass because of traveling issues, but the rest are here. And just want a quick intro. So these are 5-minute pitches. That includes the total time. So it includes usually 2 minutes plus the 3 for Q&A by our walleyes. And we'll have them introduce themselves in a second. And we will have a top prize for junior anglers, and we will have 2 prizes for the professional section, first and second place. I had to show this. This came from my high class Chinese this week, but my fortune cookie, and my wife pointed out that's a great fortune because this is all about making an entrepreneurial community. And it says, not you're going to get a fortune, you're going to inherit a fortune, you're going to make a fortune with your friend. So I hope that this fortune will pass on to everybody in the room, and then we make as a wonderful community to change the world. So that's what's going on. Quick reminder that Jamie, we're still on at Collider, even with the weather. I figure those are snowed in. We can go to Collider. And I understand that people might need to leave, but we will have escorts helping with getting to Collider afterwards. And I really hope that's a new addition. Because one, Collider wasn't ready last time, but two, the goal is to not just have this be event, but have the ability to have small individual discussions. So that's what's going on. If you have any questions, let us know. But in the meantime, I would like to meet the walleyes. These are important entrepreneurs for strategy. So grab a mic. Harry, you want to start?
Is it on? Yeah, I'm Harry Hackett. I'm a co-founder of Recombinetics. I past founded Discovery Genomics, which was acquired by ImmuSoft, and I'm a professor at the University of Minnesota.
Hello, I'm Tracy Downs. My background is a PhD in neuroscience. I've been the co-founder of Area 10 on apps for the last 15 years, and doing real estate development.
Hello, this is Andy Danielson. I'm Vice Chair of Mayo Clinic Ventures. We handle intellectual property coming from our clinicians and researchers around Mayo, and we also have both a seed and a venture fund to invest in, hopefully some winners today.
Hi, Fernando Bazan. My background is a bit different, structural biology, but I'm the CTO right now at Biotechni in Minneapolis, sort of a big-ish biotech firm over here. My background's more in biotherapeutics and drug discovery, and most recently I was at Genentech in Bayer.
Hello, I'm Will Knang, co-founder of OpenTron's LabWorks. We're a 2.5-year-old startup based in Brooklyn, and I'm excited to be here and hopefully bring some of that coastal startup fervor to Rochester.
I'm Thomas Puff. I'm a corporate finance and securities law and venture capital attorney, and we, for the last 30 years, have helped build and grow and serve U.S. growth companies with funding, debt, equity, and taking them from startup to hopefully hundreds of millions or getting sold or going public or the like. You know, one of our great successes, I would say, we were involved in the starting of Taser International in Scottsdale from the ground floor of 3 employees to now. Yesterday, when I was in Phoenix, they told me they're 400 and some odd million and 600 employees. So nice success there. So here you go, Steve.
Thank you. All right. We're set. Then I think we're going to go ahead and start. We have My Orbit. Ready? Come on down. Stephen Robinson. Like the Price is Right. Come on down. You're the next contestant. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm here today on behalf of my team to present a product that looks to be slightly different from everything else you're going to hear thereafter. So don't hold it against us. But I want to introduce you to what we think is an exciting tool that will connect your city to you. Show of hands, how many people here can tell me which exciting event will go on in Rochester on January 14th at 6 p.m.? Better yet, I'll give you another chance. What about tomorrow? You are not alone. In our market survey, more than 80% of responders did not feel like they had a good grasp of what was going on in this city. Yet, businesses are spending valuable man hours uploading this data to websites that suggest that people aren't accessing. Picture this. Just under half of our responders said they like to attend fundraising events and do. Yet 85% of responders said they would attend these events if notified in advance, and they want to be notified by a single personalized product. The information is out there. The problem is the user has to go hunting for that and sometimes painstakingly. The paradigm needs to shift. In today's world, the information needs to be fed to the user. With a growing population, we just heard DMC, for example, in Rochester, walking around with supercomputers in their pockets, with machine learning and artificial intelligence no longer esoteric, the time is ripe to provide that tool to the user. My Orbit is that tool. No longer will businesses need to spend time uploading data to websites that people aren't accessing. Our product will collate that data, filter it, giving you, the user, what you want, when you want, whether it is 4 weeks from now, 4 hours from now, or with a click of a button right now, what's going on around. In addition, your pattern of use will be analyzed by the machine learning capabilities of the program to recommend things that you may not have thought of that you would like. Our globally diverse team who want to be connected to this city, armed with experience in machine learning, web design, and app building, are ready to bring you that tool. So join us on our journey as we not only circle the city trying to find the fun things for you to do, but also land you at the heart of the action.
Import from us.
What do you want to give me? I'll take anything. What we're looking for here today is advice. We want to hear feedback from you. Also, we want you to sign up for our user sheets that will be sent around so you can be some of the elite people that join our database early. But ultimately, we want to hear, you know, what you think of our pitch. What do you think are things that we need to focus on? We have identified in our market research as nonprofits, for example, as an early customer segment to focus on. We've had suggestions. Why aren't you looking at school calendars? Why aren't you going to local businesses in town? We also have knocked around a few business model ideas. We think that our product will have the potential for exponential growth, being a one-stop shop for people to get that information to them. And so with that exponential growth and the potential to grow a user database, we believe that advertisements or even commissions as people use our tool potentially in the future to schedule appointments at these events, or even a nominal subscription free, for example, free to nonprofits and charge to businesses when they come on board. You know, what do you think is the way we should go, for example, with this? And if you want to give us money, we'd love that too.
So where are you now in the development?
So in the development, we are basically working with our team, the guys with the expertise in the building, to actually start creating the product. You know, we're not letting this hold us back, though. We're already building a user database, working with the nonprofits, trying to collate their attendees, hopefully be the distribution list, you know, we're asking attendees which events do you like, so we aren't sending those notifications to you, because people are being bombarded by multiple sources. The other thing that we are in the preliminary phase of is approaching schools to discuss whether or not we could design a tool for them that could be a personalized calendar for key events for the parents as we attempt to build it.
Time's up. So, like always, if you have more questions,
so feel free to email us, it's up there, and sign up, please. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. Right.
Through the use of simple automated platforms. Current cell culture automation systems are large and cost prohibitive, making them impractical for the average academic research lab. It doesn't have to be this way. The technology is now in place to provide a more appropriate and cost-effective solution. And by designing products that automate media changes, we will enable new labs to join the arena, reinvigorate current scientists, and accelerate the rate of stem cell research. Our first product is a self-contained system that automatically performs media changes without needing to leave the cell culture incubator. The system mounts on a standard six-well plate and uses fluid controls to exchange depleted media for fresh. With our product, you can finally spend Christmas at home without freezing down cells and losing weeks of research time. You could take one day off to recuperate and prevent burnout, and you could even stay home the next time a bad blizzard is gonna hit Minnesota.
So addressing these needs will tap into the global market for stem cell research products, a $1.2 billion industry, as well as the cell culture market, which is projected to reach $11.3 billion by 2020. Given that the volume of cell culture media consumed was projected to increase by 11% just last year, there will be an increasing need for companion products and automation for this process. This provides the perfect opportunity for us.
We hope you'll join us in making this vision a reality. We are C-Squared Solutions. Our product works, so you don't have to.
Hey, that was awesome. We had a really good conversation earlier for all you guys that don't know, so this might be out of nowhere, but I think it's first of all amazing that you guys started with a personal need that you all have and then are rapidly prototyping a solution to try and bottom up get to a market. So could you just tell the audience a little bit about what you just passed along to the Walleyes?
Yeah, so what we passed around is actually our first design prototype, and over Christmas break we're going to try to build the functional part. But it's essentially the box that's going to contain the electronics. On the bottom is a section that's going to connect to tubing that's going to go in and actually, you know, pull up and take down the media. And it fits on a regular six-well plate, which is on the bottom there. It's the clear part. And our prototype is the white part.
And then the top part has the reservoirs for the depleted and the fresh media as well. And in this particular model, you can click the top of the rig and plate.
So, question. Great presentation, by the way. So this is the disposable component. Is there a larger capital pumps or what have you? Is it compatible with existing equipment in the lab?
So the general idea is that the central component here with the electronics and pumping mechanism will fit would be a reusable part that you could sterilize. And then we would have disposable components as well that would probably be about similar to what you buy for a mobile plate. To help minimize any contamination, which we know is a huge issue.
And just to be clear, this is for media exchange, so splitting cells when they're confluent stuff.
So this is literally the stem cells and a couple other cell types need to have their media changed every single day without days off, unless you want to freeze down your cells to take a break or go to a conference or et cetera. And so this is just a media change solution.
And I guess it might be cell specific, but so if you use this as a one day usage, or could you do multiple days? It depends on the growth rate of the cells, I suppose.
So our idea is to have this at this point in time, have you have to hold enough media for a couple days worth of changes. But you could potentially reuse it. And
if your cells just needed to have their media changed every other day or something, you could set it to do that. But the main pain point is our field, stem cell research, where it needs everyday attention.
And sort of dominate the panel here, but one last question. Have you looked at intellectual property protection? Is this patentable? Is it unique? Is it novel?
So there is one device that's patent pending, which has a similar concept and design. It's quite different from this, and we can't find their patent online.
Since it's not been granted yet. But there's no other product that's this exact kind of idea.
Thank you. That's time for this one.
Oh, one final quick thing.
All right.
So the market, if I'm clear, the next essential stuff. The market is colleges, universities, research institutions, not so much the private corporate market or no.
So for our first steps, that's the plan. Is that this device and devices in this early generation is going to be targeted towards academia, but the next generation device would be a bigger platform that would. We'd like to work with companies, especially places like Regions Aeronostics that are local, to try to make that happen.
Thanks.
Surgery, and you're in the room with your therapy professional.
They just got done debriefing you, and you're swamped with stacks of paper. You have no idea what to do.
Paper instructions are hard to follow. Even when patients are shown how to do their therapy exercises, they have a hard time remembering what they need to do and how they need to do it.
So outpatients plans to bridge this communication gap with our digital healthcare platform. It seamlessly integrates the patient's tailored therapy plan into their life.
First, the patient works with the therapist to learn their track. When they're doing the exercises, the patient is recording them to learn the proper way how to do them on their own phone.
And after a few preference questions, it's put straight into their phone.
From there, the app schedules their treatment, and when it comes time for therapy, they get a personalized notification. Each notification shows their exact track actions and how they need to perform these exercises on their own personalized videos.
So the therapy market itself is a $29 billion care industry, and it's estimated about half the patients in that industry don't follow their therapy.
Outpatients represents an opportunity for employers to save on employee health care.
When employees don't recover as quick, or they don't really recover as well as they should, it costs employers a lot in productivity, and it also costs them the extra care.
Large healthcare providers providers, like hospitals and large rehabilitation centers, they rely on efficient quality care to maintain their reputation and keep their costs low.
And this is what we believe will be our first customer, these big organizations, these big employers.
And we plan to help these providers by getting their patients and their employees back to normal life quickly and in good health.
So in the future, we're going to offer this platform in a tiered program. So it's going to be based on the quantity of patients, and every extra patient beyond that quantity is an extra charge.
We would love to meet with anyone that has advice for us or just likes our product. You can reach us at outpatient.care@gmail.com or just talk to us after a while, I think. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is this a tool that basically reminds patients what exercises they have to perform? Or is this a way to communicate with a specialist?
It's a tool,
yeah.
So it's additive to what you're already getting. So it's not meant to replace what the therapy gives you. It's meant to make it easier for you to follow it and easier for you to remind you what it is.
The first part is enforcing the therapy and the plan of the therapy, the communication platform. We might do that. We're thinking about it.
It's a great idea. What do you do with senior citizens or folks over 78 due to age or maybe don't have smartphones?
So it's also a website. So there are two ways to do this. You can
they
do it with an
laptop.
App.
They don't
need the app. So it's all on internet platforms. So we make a website for them. It's personalized. So when they go home, they go on their own specific that's tailored for them website. And their videos pop up, and their instructions, and they just can go from there.
Or it can be done by a caregiver, so the caregiver can also get the app for them, which makes it much easier. And to point on that as well, we're actually focusing on entering the market on upper extremity orthopedics, so like the hand and the shoulder. So that we want to focus on that main pain point first, and then expand to other groups.
Are you anticipating, as part of this, making the videos themselves? So that it'll be customized to your app.
Some of them.
Yeah.
A subset of exercises are standardized for almost every shoulder surgery, but some of them are not, and that's why we offer the chance to record them on your phone. And there will be a subset of these videos we'll produce ourselves. Yes.
Yeah. So for some surgical procedures, so based on the hand, there might be 10 different surgical procedures per physician, and so every physician has a very specific way to do it. So that's why we already have the option of the standardized plus the personalized. And we already know that some therapists are actually already making those videos themselves.
So there is a library, and you can just drag the ones you want as a therapist. And if you can't find the specific one you want, you just click an X at the bottom, and you can make your own.
So you had the providers paying for this product, is that correct?
Yes.
That's one of our ideas, yes. We're also considering. But
and is there current reimbursement codes for outpatient therapy, or would this be something that you pitch to providers in terms of, I know, bundled care?
So we're looking into that. We have started, so bundled care. We're actually looking at the codes and different ways that they're charged, and it's going to have to be, they're trying to educate us right now. We're trying to educate on the insurance system.
You're referring to
G-codes,
I presume. Yeah. We understand that system. We're trying to fund that.
Good, yeah, I encourage you to do that because that would be key here.
Yeah.
All right.
Getting paid.
Thanks, outpatients. Time's
up.
All right. So that was our junior anglers. I think that was it is a great job of getting us launched. We enter our new professionals division, and we have a terrific leadoff hitter, Tim. But we have a little bit different. Tim, do we have like? Just the phone.
All right. To change the we just did it. Go with us? Okay.
looks like it's grabbed in here.
There it is. We're good. All right, Tim, you ready?
Good afternoon. I'm Tim Nelson. I'm the director of the Todd and Karen Wannick Family Program for Hypoplastic Left Heart. Hypoplastic left heart is the most severe congenital heart defect that causes nearly 50% of them not to be able to survive to their fifth birthday. In addition to this, in the three open heart surgeries that they require in the first 3 years of life, they have a 20% mortality rate between the first surgery and the second surgery. Our program's mission at Mayo Clinic is to develop regenerative therapies to cause regenerative solutions for these children to rebuild their heart and delay or prevent transplant for hypoplastic left heart. In order to do that, we have to have multiple tools in addition to the stem cells and the technology to regenerate. And we've developed a series of tools to be able to better monitor these patients at home. We have to be able to deliver the cells, and we have to monitor how they are doing. Born out of this need of home monitoring came Empathia, the public benefit corporation, first one to be formed at Mayo Clinic, that has been launched recently with this app that I'm going to show you today. As standard of care between the first and second surgeries of hypoplastic left heart, mothers and caregivers are required to measure heart rate, oxygen level, and write it down on a piece of paper every single day. They then call in on Monday mornings to their care team and report what the reports are of their averages of the last week. This data gets codified through paper and pencil, gets passed on to the caregivers through a series of meetings during the week, and clinical decisions of the timing of the next life-saving surgery is dependent on the memory of the mother and a paper and pencil that may be lost. This was the origins of starting a tool that allowed us to collect a mobile app to be able to digitize this information. And quite simply, this application allows us to enter the primary data, in this case body weight, as you can see, that can be either directly manually entered or can be Bluetooth connected with other devices in the home setting. In addition to that, then we can quite quickly calculate the averages and display these trends as you can see here. And this trend of body weight going up, oxygen stats going down, and heart rate going up is a very bad sign, and this patient needs to come into the hospital as soon as possible. But this could have been forgotten if it had been done just on a paper and pen and not recorded in real time.
Attention Mayo staff. At this time, Mayo Clinic is declaring the emergency staffing plan. Supervisors should assess their work units to ensure
this isn't part of my presentation.
To meet current and future patient needs.
They'll repeat it again.
Attention Mayo staff. At this time, Mayo Clinic is declaring the emergency staffing plan. Supervisors should assess their work units to ensure adequate staffing levels to meet current and future patient needs.
That means you're all fine, no worries. In addition to this, we have created quite a simple platform where you can simply share your data and you can select what you want to share with whom you want to share it. And this allows anybody to use it anywhere to better integrate with the standard of care. This is a reimbursable code, standard of care for all of these patients, and adding a digital platform like this is an additional way of adding value to what we're currently doing. How does this fit in with our program's mission? The Public Benefit Corporation that we've created allows us to create and use this tool to advance our research and track and monitor how patients respond to stem cell therapies, but also now allows us to compare that data to every patient across the country that uses this app to compare how their outcomes are compared to patients that don't get the stem cells. But we've also created the Public Benefit Corporation as a for-profit, for-patient entity that allows this to be scaled and expanded in other ways to come back and help the mission of the HLHS program that's founded here at Mayo Clinic. Thank you for your attention.
So could you give us a sense for how this is being used today?
So how it's being used today is those of you that are interested can go to iTunes, and you type in HLHS, and you can download it and test it for yourself. This tool is really just a digital replication of what the paper and pencil is today. This free tool is available for everybody today that you can download. Unfortunately, only available to the iPhone right now, and the Android users are left out in the cold.
Can the app talk to Fitbits, for instance? I mean, so many people now have these personal sensors that record things like heart rate and exercise.
What we're looking for today and going forward is to find the partners to better integrate the sensor community that is built to do these things. Accelerometers, the Fitbits, the oxygen, the heart rate, all of these technologies that are being developed, some of them are open OEM type of devices and others are closed systems that only allow you to communicate with their own software. So we're very actively trying to find the motivated partners that want to be part of the Public Benefit Corporation and the HLHS mission to be able to align that. And we believe that there are sensor technologies out there that could test their model system in our rare disease, orphan drug status, HLHS population.
Thanks, Tim.
Thank you.
Dexter's going crazy.
Okay. My name is Jeff Reiner, and I'm president and co-founder with my partner Dave Roser of Mint Farm. Our mission in life is to advance plant-based medicine. We are seeking $750,000 in convertible debt in $100,000 or greater increments. This debt will get 8% over 3 years, and then at the point of conversion, we'll get a 10% discount on stock. We are currently working with two qualified investor groups with these terms. So what is Mint Farm? What do we do? So we are a manufacturer of recombinant proteins for medical research. Not very exciting, except for we do it a little differently. We do it in tobacco plants. Tobacco plants are very transgenic, which means you can express proteins, most proteins, in tobacco plants. It only takes about 7 days to express these proteins. And it's a safer method because of the lack of bacteria in plants. The exciting part about what we're doing, though, is the benefit to the research community. Because of the inexpensive way that we are manufacturing these recombinant proteins, it can save up to 90% the cost that researchers are currently paying for the proteins that they're purchasing. We were established in 2014. Working very hard over the last couple of years, getting all the licenses and patents and IP in place for our protocol. We have proof of concept. We are currently producing proteins, but we are only producing proteins that have already been expressed in tobacco plants. The reason why we're doing that is because we want to succeed. No FDA approval should be necessary with the proteins that we produce because it's for the research community. So that means that as soon as we have proteins that are the right purity and the right chemical structure that is desirous of the in the research community, we can start selling it, start making revenues, and making all of our investors happy. The protein that we are currently working on is VEGF. It's a regenerative protein. It's used in cancer therapeutics and macular degeneration. It's also used in anti-VEGF and all regenerative proteins right now are kind of an exploding market. Anti-VEGF market is growing at about $1 billion a year. We are moving our offices. We've been in Maplewood for the last couple of years, and We're going to be occupying new space, moving in February into the old IBM Imation building. They've carved out 150,000 square feet for a biotech incubator. You guys should check it out. It's run by IncuBiology. We have 1,200 square feet there, and we feel that we'll be able to do about $2 to $2.5 million in that space. We've had a lot of support over the last couple of years, and it seems to just keep growing. And I think the reason for that is, you know, because of the benefit that we're going to bring to the research market. So I just have one question for you all, and that is, who wants to go walleye ice fishing with Min Farm?
And what's the use of proceeds on the 700, and who are the bankers you're talking to?
Okay, so we haven't raised any money yet. It's been just Dave and I self-funding over the last 2 years. Dave actually owns a building in Maplewood that we've been occupying, and so it's time to upgrade. It's a nice building, Dave, no offense. And what were the other questions?
Use of proceeds on the 700, and who are the bankers or something?
Yeah, use of funds is basically to buy a lot better equipment than we're using right now, R&D, and then some more talent in the labs.
So, go ahead.
What's the status of the IP? I mean, famously, ZMAP, the anti-Ebola virus antibody 2 years ago was made from tobacco.
That's very true. Yeah, you're talking about the Ebola? Yeah. Yes, and just for the folks know, the Ebola scare that was a couple of years ago. That was actually a cure that was made in tobacco plants.
And secondly, what are the advantages of, you know, VEGF made in tobacco versus VEGF made by insect cells?
Well, cost. I mean, right now VEGF is the average that we can tell, you know, looking at all the suppliers right now, is about $4,400 a milligram. And what we're going to be coming out with our VEGF is right around $550 a milligram. So quite a savings. There's a lot of other research that, you know, can't be done because the price is prohibitive. And so I think you're going to see a lot of other research ability just because we can supply a lot at a large volume at a low price.
So we've been doing, we're in different molecular farming, but we've been doing very dense indoor farming for at least 6 years. And so what we've done is taken that technology and when your example, what you're mentioning is, what that company has is about 90,000 square feet of greenhouse. We can condense that into 6,000 square feet of warehouse. So it's big savings.
So we're out of time, but Andy can ask his question. It's quick, just do
that. Yeah, real quick question. My question was on cost there, and I think you've answered that well, but my second question was on turnaround time. So, you know, inserting a gene into a bacteria or a cell to produce protein, and then I guess I don't understand how long does it take the plant to grow, produce the protein, and be harvested? So if I ordered a, you know, protein from you today, is it, you know, wait 8 weeks while my plant grows, or is there a faster mechanism?
No, we have about 10,000 plants growing right now. And so at the point of infiltration, it's actually 7 days later where the protein's actually expressed. And so then we have a couple of days after that to extract and purify and have it available. Different proteins are different amount of expression time, but you know, it's typically around 7-10 days.
Thank you.
Everybody. Hi, I'm Brian Brinkworth. I'm here on behalf of Intent Health. We are a medical device company in St. Paul, just a few miles up north. And we build wearable neurodiagnostics for everybody down the line, but initially we're focusing on people that have neurological disorders. Right now the company is just these two guys. One's me, the other one is Professor Newton Howard. He's actually at the University of Oxford, but he's been at MIT. He's got a very distinguished history. He worked with founded the MIT Mind Machine Project, which is a big AI deal about 10 years ago. Marvin Minsky and everybody was involved in that. And he's founded another, the Synthetic Intelligence Laboratory, which focuses on artificial consciousness, and now familiar with as deep machine learning. And then from there, he got into the actual structure of the brain. He had to figure out how the brain worked in order to solve the problem of artificial intelligence. And so he went to University of Oxford, got a neurology degree, got a neurosurgery degree. He's got a lot of letters behind his name. He's an academic for his whole life. He's been in the military besides that, built a lot of different applications. Some of the artificial intelligence that he worked with was used to redesign command and control systems for the U.S. military. find terrorists using some of this artificial intelligence software. So most recently he's been interested in medical applications of this for neurological disorders. And the big problem we're trying to solve is this problem of finding neurological disorders, diagnosing them, and taking good care of them. It's a huge, huge problem. You guys probably have seen these numbers before. It's going to get incredibly expensive in the years ahead as everybody's aging. Big problem that we're trying to solve is that these are undiagnosable. They're not showing up in blood tests or scans or anything like that. Most of the tests that people have are just a subjective examination that they may take. We're looking for a tool that will be able to diagnose these quantitatively, objectively, and very accurately. We have been doing this for the last couple of years with a system that will, hold on. We need a tool that's accurate and objective. Screenings are presently subjective. We need clinical diagnostic support. But the big problem is that you need to be able to scan people for a very long period of time, not just 24 hours. You need to be able to track them all the time so you can see what the triggers are and see how the environmental factors impact their state. And our solution here is we've got some wireless earbuds that have EEG, ECG, pulse oximetry, true body temperature, and an accelerometer inside of them. You communicate those to an app on the smartphone, which communicates back to the cloud. In the cloud, we've got deep machine learning. We also have deep machine learning in the app and on the earbuds, and that is providing a diagnostic capability. We can detect Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, PTSD, depression, very high rates of accuracy. That's not being done right now. So we've got two different parts to it. We've got multimodal analysis, which is our special sauce. The fundamental code unit is this FCU. I can't talk about that in 2 minutes, but basically it takes all of this sensory data, combines it together, puts deep machine learning to it, and provides this diagnostic capability. Yes, you hear me okay? Okay. Which gives continuous patient care. And then multimodal diagnostics takes all of this data, puts it in a patient profile, and this is going to be a very, very big thing because you're able to look at the same thing in a very, very different way and find patterns and biomarkers that you wouldn't be able to see normally. Our target market is pharmaceutical companies that are trying to spend find new drugs. They spend hundreds of millions of dollars. We're going to get more data than they've ever been able to get for their patients. Also, healthcare companies, we're trying to lower the cost and the visitation rate while we're increasing the quality of care. There's a lot of reasons why they would want to push that. We're hoping they will. Chronic care patients are great, have a big need for this. So all of these conditions would be potential. We've got three different areas. One, we're just tracking what everybody's doing. The next phase, we're going to do diagnostics. And the third phase, we're going to bring it to consumer. So the secondary markets, once we're able to do the diagnostics and get the FDA approval, then we think that neurologists and physicians, hospitals would be interested in it. You can put it in somebody's ear, you know who they are, you know what they have, you know their vitals and everything, and you can direct them around the hospital because their voice can be in the ear. Also, you can tell if somebody's telling the truth, you can tell if they're stressed, you can tell if they're anxious, so it helps with therapy and everything else.
So time's up.
Time is up. I'm not even close. So. Any questions? I don't have time for it. But
one question.
That's a lot to pack into these neural buds, and also those things probably get lost very easily by people that are forgetful or
yes.
ill. Do they need to be neural buds? I mean,
But they're attached to one another, so they won't just one won't fall out. But yeah, it's great to get all of this sensory out of the ear. You get the true body temperature, you got the blood there. So yeah, very good here.
Rick.
Okay, I'm Carson Wagner, Rick Wagner at the University of Minnesota, and I'm a professor there and chief scientific officer of TICON. How many people here have had had a family member or someone that they know have cancer? About everybody. In the last 2 years, I've had 6 friends get cancer, 3 of them die of cancer. And so one of our goals is to provide and look for life-extending, versatile, and safe cancer immunotherapies. Our company was founded about a year ago. I'm a co-founder along with InVenture in the University of Minnesota. Our CEO is Danny Cunningham, who is our InVenture managing partner. We have strong IP. We have 4 issued patents, actually one just issued this week. And we have a pre-series A funding of about $1.5 million. Now, the pillars of cancer treatment, as you all know, are radiation, surgery, chemotherapy, and most importantly, in the last 5 years, most excitement has been in immunotherapy, mainly because it can potentially be curative. Our approach is based on a nanotechnology platform called chemical subassembly nanoparticles, and we can take a protein, in which case these 2 proteins, one which can target a T cell, one which can target an antigen. We then assemble those into nanorings, which are extremely stable, and they have 2 functionalities, being able to bind to the T cell, and when they bind to the T cell, they bind to the T cell almost irreversibly. These allow us to then target to the cancer cell, activate the cancer cell, and kill the cancer cell. This approach has been validated in the lab, in the test tube, and also in an animal model. We can also have an approach, and one of the main things about this is our ability to take a small molecule trimethoprim, an FDA-approved drug, and actually wipe these from the surface. This allows us a critical safety mechanism for allowing us to deactivate the T cells, which is one of the big issues with any T cell-based therapy. Now, advantages, we refer to these as prosthetic antigen receptors, or PARs. They're stable on the cell membrane, and you can modify a T cell membrane in minutes. You don't need genetic engineering. There's no potential long-term toxicities. They're favorable pharmacokinetics in tissue distribution. We have multiple potential antigenic targets we can target. We can use blood or solid tumors, and there's a built-in safety mechanism for these. In addition, we have initiated and shown proof of concept that we can be able to use these for image-guided immunotherapy, which would be really nice. The market for this, there is currently 1 bispecific antibody in the market for antigen. This year alone, it will do $120 million in sales. It's the second year. It had a 50% increase. Others, there's a number of checkpoint inhibitor. This is an antibody as well, which activates the immune system, and this was about $1 billion last year. And the projected market for 2020 is cancer immunotherapy will be an $8 billion market. Right now, we're looking for engaging strategic investors and clinical partners, and thank you. Yeah, so the point for the regulatory path is, of course, that's about IND and all that. But in this case, it would be treated as a biologic and not a cell-based therapy, which is an advantage. Right now, for example, for CAR T-cell therapies, there really is no understood path for that right now. There's no FDA-approved approach. Even for the production of materials, there's no FDA-approved pathway for that. It's happened to be worked out. With this approach, we believe we have an advantage because it's essentially a biotech drug, a chemically induced biotech drug. So it has that advantage. Capital, we think we need at least probably $10 million for the Series A. The Series A, probably up to $30 million to get to the Series B.
The nanoring, it's still comprised of
potentially immunogenic?
Yeah, so that's a issue in any immunotherapy. It doesn't even, actually, even if it immunizes, it's immunogenicity. You go to meetings on this, in immunogenicity, right through protein. In our hands, when we've done mice experiments, we find actually almost no immunogenicity. So we think for that is because they're kind of unique in that they hold, the rings are very stable, and when they're taken up in the cells, they're not processed by the MHC. They're just held extremely stable, we know they're stable. But that's as far as we go. Yes?
In the academic clinical trials anticipated?
Yeah, we would like to. That's the next goal, is why we would like to get a clinical partner to begin having those discussions and begin planning that the clinical development as soon as possible, actually.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so we're going to have a 15-minute break. There are snacks in the back and coffee. So for those that, and there's caffeine. So 15 minutes, so 3:15, if you can come on down, and we will resume. Gretchen, you're on deck. So if you can come down in a couple of minutes, and if you're watching online, we will start up in about 20 minutes. Again, thank you.
Because you've had a spinal cord injury. And you're not going to know that sore is there until it begins to smell. And when it begins to smell, that means it's getting infected. And if you let it go beyond that, you'll get septic. And if you get septic, you could potentially die. What we're talking about here is pressure ulcers, okay? 7.4 million of them worldwide every year. That's more than the population of Minnesota, South Dakota, and North Dakota combined. And we spend $12 billion treating these pressure ulcers. That's more than the NFL and the NHL make in a year combined. Yet this is completely solvable. It's ridiculous that we haven't solved this. So what we're going to do is we're going to solve it with sensors and software. We have sensors that monitor the pressure, humidity, and temperature under an array that you place under the bottom of the individual in the wheelchair. We can then take that information and wirelessly transmit it to an iPhone or other mobile device, show them the values, also have software that analyzes that, looks for high pressure points, high temperature, high humidity, and we'll be able to feed that back to them and say, you have to move now, or you are damaging your skin. Founding team consists of myself and Tammy Voss-Draper, who's had 25 years dealing with exactly these kind of problems. We're currently working on licensing 15 different patents. We have prototype software. We have a distribution partner who is the world's largest manufacturer of powered wheelchairs. We have research and validation conducted both here at Mayo and at the Veterans Administration in Minneapolis, and we've developed products like this before. In the next 6 months, we're going to be working on a capital raise, finishing up the Generation 1 product, and working on the IP for the Generation 2 product. Projections are that in 5 years, we'll be a $33 million annual revenue company. And that's all I have, except to say that we can show you a demo on the back, and we also have t-shirts and mugs in case you want to support this effort. Thank you.
my understanding that pressure ulcers are especially prevalent in diabetic populations, and you didn't mention that.
I didn't mention two different populations. Diabetic is one of them, and also hospital beds. We're working, the initial product will be focused on seated mobility, but those two are definitely in the courthouse, bill house, whatever they know. Yeah. So it's really interesting. I don't know if you know, like, Christopher Reeve, Superman. It wasn't Batman and it wasn't Kryptonite that killed him. It was actually a pressure ulcer. And the complications from that. He became septic and killed him. And the problem is, it's like, how many people do you want to go and say, hey, can you check my blood? You know, that's literally kind of the problem. You have to be very comfortable with your caregiver. They have to be able to look at you, evaluate you on an ongoing basis. That's really the problem. This is completely solvable by just moving. But if you don't know it hurts, you don't feel it, you don't move because you're engaged in something else, and that's what got him. Any other questions?
I'm still kind of curious why you're not actively pursuing a market where just by mentioning diabetes and possible solutions to complications, you don't automatically engage millions and millions of people and thereby just increase the audience to which you're marketing your product.
So the main reason is that currently we're working on the sensor technology, and you have to actually be able to get that into a foot related sensor. So there's some challenges there. We already know what the map will look like and how that works, and we have the expertise in that. So as we bring on people to evaluate new markets, that's definitely, trust me, we have no worries about expanding.
Thank you. Thanks, Hunter.
Scott, I'm President and CEO of GeneticCare, one of the co-founders. We are taking the long-standing promise of personalized medicine and bringing it into clinical practice. Rather than dipping our toe in the water with a small disease, fortunate for us, our technology is a perfect fit for the largest disease in the clinical setting, which is hypertension or high blood pressure. So this is our team. I'm proud to say I'm a Rochester native, but we're relatively split between the Twin Cities and Rochester. Most of our team came through Mayo in some capacity or another. Some are still here. A little bit more about high blood pressure. It's the largest disease in the U.S., affecting about 80 million Americans, and roughly half of those do not have it under control. And even more surprising is 40% of those taking the prescriptions as prescribed are not under control. The reason is that they're on the wrong drug. So we've all heard that hypertension or high blood pressure is the silent killer and very dangerous. Unfortunately, or fortunately, it's non-symptomatic. It leads to all these downstream catastrophic events like heart attack and stroke. It's the leading preventable risk factor for death worldwide, and responsible for about approaching 400,000 deaths per year. So the challenge lies in the way that it's treated today in the standard of care, which is a process of trial and error. The clinician generally prescribes the first drug, the same first drug to all patients, generally a diuretic. They titrate that up to the maximum tolerable dose, and then layer on a second drug, and sometimes ultimately a third drug. This process takes on average about 65 weeks from diagnosis to control, and can take even longer. The challenge is that patients will often bail on their therapy and remain uncontrolled until one of those deadly or expensive events happens. So we've discovered a better way, and we've patented this approach, and it's a very unique solution in the field of pharmacogenomics. So what we've done is looked at the functional causes of the disease in the renal system, the heart, and the vascular system, and we've identified the functional genes that are responsible for drug response in those three main classes of drugs: diuretics, vasodilators, and beta blockers. We've also included two genes that regulate drug metabolism, CYP2D6 and CYP2C19, which you see on the top. That's where most of our competitors stop, is on drug metabolism. But the interesting thing with a disease like hypertension is you can have 10, 20-fold the amount of the drug in the bloodstream, but unless you have an appreciation for the drug target, it's ineffective. So what makes us unique? Our team, we have a really robust team of leaders in their field, NIH-funded PhDs, and a couple of not-so-smart entrepreneurs that work really hard. Our science is very unique. This approach that has an appreciation for the integrated physiology is unique to what we're doing. And most importantly, in this world of personalized medicine or precision medicine, unfortunately, most companies approach the market without strong clinical evidence. We have a very robust phase one study that we've completed, and we're in the middle of enrolling the largest prospective personalized medicine for high blood pressure ever done. And we believe strongly in supporting all of our technology with clinical evidence and clinical utility. The value proposition here is a great reduction in the cost of care. We estimate in year one we have a $20 billion addressable market for high blood pressure alone. We're working on two additional disease states as we speak. And the benefit to the healthcare system is a great reduction in cost. So 30% on average we think we can pull out of the healthcare system by eliminating this inefficient process. So that's it, and that's just for our first panel. Like I mentioned, we're working hard and should have a second one with a patent early next year.
Are you going to have access to the big Mayo Clinic personalized database or genomics database that's being set up? And
potentially. So we're exploring relationships with Mayo in a number of different capacities, and that's one of them, on development for future pipeline products. We own all of our IP as Geneticure for hypertension, but there's future collaboration to be had. So we're attending at the Mayo Business Accelerator, have taken an investment from Ready, and so on. So that's coming, we hope. Sure, we just finished a $1 million round. I funded the company through our first clinical study, which was administered through RCRI in the Twin Cities, third party. We did 100 subjects in that study. Then we raised $1 million to drive early adoption. So we're commercializing today as an LDT. And that $1 million will get us through data readouts on our 800 subject study, which is enrolling as we speak. And then we'll raise Series A probably likely after that.
And what's the... the market here in terms of, right, is this a direct patient, is this billed to payers,
Right. We believe strongly in the clinician being the center of care. We're post-diagnostic. We're not direct-to-consumer. We're another clinical decision support tool for the doctor to optimize care. So we believe strongly in that. We return results only to clinicians.
So eventually you need to get a code and reimbursement.
Yeah, there's a couple of CPT codes that we can lean on for those drug metabolizing enzymes, CYP2D6, CYP2C19, reimburse about $400-ish, which more than covers the cost of our test. But we are interested in talking to accountable care organizations, provider-owned health plans, those that have an appreciation for the cost of the disease. And then when we finish our second large study, which is head-to-head against the standard of care, we will be seeking our own custom CPT code.
All right, thank you.
How are you doing? Here, I'm from Florida. I hope I could buy you some sunshine, but it didn't work out that way. I might be snowed in this weekend. The reason I'm here is to tell you about a really exciting company called Allergy, whose mission in life is to make the lives of diabetes much easier than it is today. We've developed a technology that will allow people to monitor their blood sugar without having to prick themselves, which 90% of diabetics have to do today. You're talking about over 200 million Americans that have to do that. 420 million people all around the world. It's a big deal. And it's something that is easy to solve. But no one has been successful so far. I've spent my life doing things that are impossible for the government. I did research for DARPA. I was a director of engineering for Stanford Research Institute's Marine Space Technology Group. And we invented things that were impossible to solve, problems that had to be solved. We developed ways of communicating underwater using RF technologies. And we developed high dielectric materials to solve critical problems. The irony of the whole thing is that all this time, 20 years of doing this, I never did it for myself. Did it for something other than for the government. But when my wife almost died from diabetes and I watched my father die within one amputation at a time over many, many years, when my wife almost died, I just got it right before she was going to go into a coma. I decided that, why can't I just use what I've been using all along, working for the government? Why don't I use that approach? So I sat down and I did the research. I talked to people around the world, and after about 3 months, I found a way to do it. And the irony is that people I've worked with over the last 20 years are part of the team. So basically, what we're going to be doing is addressing a critical need in an existing market with a disruptive technology. And we have a prototype in the lab that we've demonstrated that it works, and there's all kinds of literature from all kinds of research institutes that document that you could use dielectric spectroscopy as a method to quantify the blood sugar level in a human being real time. It's just not practical to do it using normal technologies. So we're going to be raising about $2.5 million over the next two rounds. We're starting off with an initial round of $250,000 to start, $500,000 to stop the first round, which will be an angel round. This just shows you the market that exists right now. The other side of the market that we're going to look at is the long-term market of people that don't even know they have diabetics, which is a third of this country is borderline diabetic and they don't know it. How can we modify their behavior to avoid them from becoming diabetic? So at this point in time, I think I've kind of talked about some of the basics of what we're doing. Does anybody have any questions?
So do you have a device?
Yes, I have a lab device, and I have a prototype device I can show you that demonstrates how it's going to work in a wristband.
Do you have clinical data?
We have preclinical data from the lab, from the lab-based system, but the problem is you can't take something that is in a room and make it a portable system. So the money that we're going to be using in our first round will be to build the wristband device, and I have a prototype device to show that after me.
On your website, you also show another device that's coupled to the smartphone, where you do use.
No, that's showing you what the fingerprint is. That's showing the fingerprint. We have to modify that page because it's confusing. Yeah, so what we're trying to do is do away that. Our big advertising thing online, my son's a marketeer and just graduated in that area. Everything's a hashtag to him. So our hashtag is pound stop the prick. I think it's registered. I don't have to check on that. Any other questions? Thank you very much.
I'm sure Mark would be happy to talk to anybody at Collider. Yeah.
Steve, Xavi, and Jamie for inviting me. I'm Andres Acosta. I'm an assistant professor at Mayo Clinic. And I'm going to talk today about my company that I started before I came to Mayo Clinic when I was at the University of Florida, finishing my PhD. Our company name is Gila Therapeutics. We're trying to develop a product to make you feel full faster, and this is an innovative solution for obesity. So as we have just heard before from many talks, obesity is a major problem. Around 200 million Americans are suffering from being overweight or obese. And the market for these, between direct and indirect costs, is around $550 billion a year. Obesity is the major modifiable cause for cardiovascular disease, diabetes, cancer, and many other conditions. And about 110 million Americans a year try to lose weight. And they spend significant amount of money in interventions, almost $200 billion in diet, medications, or surgery. Only 400 million of these are spent on medications that are very ineffective and not safe. So obesity remains to be a huge unmet medical need. One of the things to understand these is that satiety can be a major player in obesity management. Satiety is mainly regulated by our brain, but it's induced by this hormone that comes out from our gut called peptide YY. It goes to our systemic circulation, and then it goes to the hypothalamus, or to the brainstem, and activates our centers that makes us feel full. Many people have tried to deliver injectables, subcutaneous IVs, subcutaneous pills, and unfortunately they have not been successful because when you increase PYY's circulation, you produce nausea. So while I was doing my PhD, we found a novel interesting pathway showing that these peptides also come into saliva and activate our taste perception, our taste receptors, and modify our sensation of fullness by a completely new pathway that has been previously never described. We submitted a patent with this, and then studying rodents, we were able to intraoral delivery these peptides into the oral cavity and make mice eat less without producing any nausea. So as you can see here, and it's the only science slide that I'm going to show, at higher doses of PYY, there's a decrease in food intake, and when you do this for 8 weeks, these mice lose around 22% more compared to the controls who actually gain weight. So we were very excited about this, so we decided to spin out this technology from Florida and start a company. This company is called Gila Therapeutics. We have an exclusive license from the University of Florida. And the next thing we did is we put a very strong team together. Tom Vasicek, our CEO, has more than 20 years of experience in Medtronic and trying to do obesity in the Medtronic team. Myself as a scientific supporter, and then John Friedman is our chief scientific officer. We have a very strong team of advisors. Bill Van Anwert has more than 62 patents in different delivery of peptides and proteins. He developed the insulin mini pump. Donna Ryan is a top expert in obesity, and then Chris Fischetti has also a strong background in pharma and developing products. So where are we right now? We're trying to develop to raise $4 million. We already have $3.4 million, and that made us that we started our program back in July. So we're currently in December, we're on target. In the next 6 months, we're planning to complete our tox studies, submit our IND, and by the summer of next year, do our first in humans. And we're just on target. So in summary, we have a strong preclinical data, we have an experienced team, we have an exclusive IP license that was issued last month from University of Florida. We've already raised $3.4 million. We want to raise up to $4 million by the end of the year. We have a positive response from the FDA in a pre-IND meeting. We have established a preclinical and clinical development plan. We have API, manufacturing regulatory process already in place. And we plan to do in the next 6 months, file IND, finish our proof of concept, and then hopefully partner with a big pharma to do a larger phase trial. Thank you for your attention. I'll be happy to take any questions.
So what does your end product look like if I were to take it?
So we're right now thinking about two different concepts. One is a dissolvable strip, like the Listerine packages. You're going to sit on a table, you put it under your tongue, you wait 5 minutes, you start eating, you feel full, or a dissolvable tablet. Initially, we start thinking also that a gum might be a good approach, but then we think, where are you going to put the gum after, you know, after you chew it? So those are the two products we're developing right now.
Balloon technologies. Have you been hearing about those for obesity? Balloon technologies too?
Yeah, that's what I do for living here at Mayo. I'm an obesity expert and a gastroenterologist, so we place all these balloons for weight loss.
How do you know that it doesn't cause nausea if it's only been in studies?
Well, in animals, we have done very elaborate studies, doing behavioral studies in animals, as well as study the brain of these mice, to make sure we're not activating the nausea centers. But the only way to know is to do a test in humans. And that's what the proof of concept is for. Yeah.
All right, thank you.
From the University of Minnesota. The University of Minnesota is a full partner in how we build the Walleye Tank, and I just wanted, Allison Hubble is unfortunately stuck in the university committee, and she couldn't get out. But we really are hoping to be much more deliberate about continuing this collaboration in the upper Midwest, including the University of Minnesota. The Walleye Tank may end up being at the University of Minnesota next as a venue, but I just wanted to. Wonderful representation. I thought I'd make sure I thank Allison, even if I'm sure we're having way more fun than she is. So, great. Take it away.
Well, thank you. I'm Yanis Kasnesis. I'm a professor in chemical engineering at the University of Minnesota. I'm also founder of General Probiotics. What we do is we develop antimicrobial technologies to target multi-drug resistant pathogens in humans and in livestock. What we particularly work on is engineering probiotic organisms to express and secrete antimicrobial peptides. Using computational biology and synthetic biology techniques, we can engineer these antimicrobial proteins to target pathogens specifically and strongly. We use probiotic organisms that are safe to consume, are bioresistant and can reach the gastrointestinal tract of hosts. So we really use probiotic organisms as the production factories and the delivery vehicles for these antimicrobial proteins. We have shown in animal studies that we can eliminate vancomycin-resistant enterococci with our antimicrobial probiotics in mouse models or salmonella in poultry models. So this is technology that is being funded right now with a phase one SBIR grant from the National Science Foundation, and it is covered by two patent applications by the University of Minnesota. Indeed, what we're trying to do is establish a platform that we can use to launch different kinds of antimicrobial probiotics targeting different pathogens in various hosts. The aim overall, the strategy is nothing less than to develop a transformative antimicrobial technology to fight difficult to treat multi-drug resistant pathogens, to improve human health, and to improve the secure safe food production. We are recruiting a team of talented engineers and scientists to get into the cycle of discovery, development, scaling up, testing. And what we're doing right now is seeking partnerships and financing to initiate the regulatory path to scale up manufacturing and to broaden our portfolio against different pathogens. Thank you.
So I'm assuming this, or is this regulated by the USDA in terms of getting into the, and you have a plan there to address that?
So the first entry point is to use microbial probiotics as preventive measures in the feed. The USDA will take over. If we are successful, the next step would be to have a label for treating pathogens in poultry and in livestock. The FDA will take care of that. And then when we go different scale up for human use, certainly it is the FDA's license.
So this just follows up that since this is a GMO, in essence, it's a little more than, it's a absolutely fortified probiotic. And does that introduce complications with the FDA, even at the earliest stages?
So in principle, genetically modified organisms are indeed legal to be used as therapeutics, as live therapeutic product. There are additional environmental assessment tests besides the test of efficacy and safety that one has to undertake in order to get approval from the FDA.
Same questions last time. If I'm an end consumer taking your drug, what does that look like? Am I drinking Yoplait yogurt, or
you can put it in Greek yogurt for sure? But it works.
And you have data in terms of targeting. You mentioned you could target various organisms specifically.
Yes.
A couple questions. How is that generally done? And two, do you have data showing that you can target a specific bacterium rather than potentially disrupting the normal flora?
So we want to target salmonella in poultry, right? We're going to identify peptides that we know target salmonella. We're going to engineer and optimize these peptides to target salmonella specifically. In the poultry animals that we have run, indeed, we see that salmonella can be eliminated by 97%, while at the same time for the birds that have been treated with salmonella, have been salvaged with salmonella, we see no change in the microflora profile between the treated and the untreated birds with our probiotics.
Can the bacteria evolve to invade the antimicrobials?
Yes, in principle they will, as with any therapeutic treatment. What we do right now is use two or three antimicrobial peptides in polycystronic constructs, peptides with different mechanisms of action so that we can suppress and mitigate this risk.
So last question, you mentioned interest in human disease, and obviously you're focused on agriculture, but what are your plans for, or do you have plans for human conditions, human and animal?
So vancomycin-resistant enterococcal strains are clinical isolates from collaborators with the University of Minnesota. These are the ones that we're targeting right now. And then we're starting a collaboration with VA Hospital, MD these target UTI E. coli. So we're in the phase right now of engineering the probiotic, having in vitro results, and then we're doing animal study.
How would that clinical application be within general probiotics as well, or would that be a separate company?
General probiotics.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
I have one announcement. Scott Haas, I have something that came on the floor that you definitely want, so you should see me before you leave.
Okay.
Maybe it's donating to Walleye Tank. That would be really appreciated.
There's one
right there. Walleye Tank presentation.
Thanks very much for having us here. I'm Bruce Lee VC. I'm the founder of Cover Metal. So, as a surgeon, I found that my patients were being unnecessarily exposed during the surgical procedures. We often put a blue towel to cover the genitals and the blue towels on the floor. And I'm yelling at the residents, blue towel, blue towel, blue towels on the floor. And I looked and there was no available product that could actually allow me to do the surgery. Cover people's genital areas. So I went home to my wife and I said, there has to be a better way. So our mission is to raise the standard of care for patient privacy and dignity by providing medical garments that cover the patient's genital area during medical and surgical procedures, but still allows access to the medical professionals to do the procedure. When we started looking at the market size, there's about almost 10 million procedures in the US alone that can use the device. At approximately $20 to $25 per garment, they gave a potential market of over $250 million worldwide, about a billion. Not to mention the fact that patient satisfaction is now at the top of the priority list for most hospital organizations. We have two models that are launching in December and January, a bilateral unit that has a front panel that actually accordions to the center so you can get access to both groin areas, and a unilateral design that gives tremendous protection on one side while leaving the other side exposed for the medical procedure. It's a soft, comfortable, non-woven material. It's breathable, moisture-wicking fabric. It's highly adjustable and uses baby elastics and Velcro, and it's not manufactured with natural rubber latex. It comes in five sizes. It's individually packaged and disposable. It's convenient in a gravity-fed dispenser, and it's considered an FDA-regulated Class 1 medical device. We've put together a tremendous all-star team. We've completed our product development. We have five design and utility patents pending, and we've completed our product and company branding. We've exceeded capital investment goals. We've achieved low-cost manufacturing. We've already signed a purchase agreement with the Mayo Clinic, and we actually launched and made our first sale this week. Now, why is Cover Medical so important? Find out as soon as the slide comes back. Why is Cover Medical so important? As William Mayo said in 1910, the best interest of the patient is the only interest to be considered. Thank you. So I can let Romeo is our CCO. He's got 25, 35 years in medical device. He's kind of known as Mr. Purell. He's the one that drove Purell into hospitals.
Hi. So to answer your question, all of the components are manufactured in the United States. It is then sent to an area called Reynosa, Mexico, which is part of the NAFTA Free Trade Zone, where it is assembled, sewn. And then it is re-imported into the United States and is warehoused in Buffalo, New York. So margins, depending, of course, on what type of prices, the full list prices, you're talking margins in the 80% range. Hospitals tend not to buy list prices.
related design?
Absolutely. I mean, we have five patents, three of which are design and two of which are utility.
Now, the utility patent is any medical or surgical procedure in the hip, pelvis, or groin area that would require general coverage. So that is a pretty broad worldwide utility application.
Didn't the blanket guys just get sold and forget the thing that was around for 20 years? Heating the blanket thing in the surgery care. Yeah.
What was the question, sir?
Oh, didn't it just sell last couple of months? No, that's somebody
could. Yeah, I don't.
So a related question to that. So do you see this as, you know, future products and turn this into a business, or have you had discussions with folks like Kimberly Clark or Bob Fairhugger as, you know, where do you see the exit for your company?
We've not had those discussions yet, but we are hoping to have those in the future. We've raised $750,000.
Thank you. Our walleyes follow Carl. Please tap. Come on down. Six of you. Just a couple quick announcements so you know what's going on. The walleyes are retreating to their, what do you call it, fortress of solitude to deliberate on all of the pitches you've heard here today. In the meantime, while they're deliberating, I'm taking over, which is kind of cool. My name is Jamie Sunsbach, and I am the community manager of Collider Coworking. Hopefully, all of you are looking forward to coming and hanging out with us. Even if it means going through about two blocks of snow. So just so we know how to feed you appropriately, how many people are planning to head over to Collider afterwards? Do about half an hour. All right, Preston, you counting? No? Awesome. Got it? Thank you. So we're going to keep it rolling. This next section is what we're calling bait shops. These are local, typically local service providers that can do a lot towards furthering ideas, companies here in the Rochester area. But before that, we have one special presentation by, let's see, I always forget your name, by Insider's View, and they'll tell you why they're a special presentation right now.
All right, thanks very much. We will be picturing all of you naked for the next 5 minutes, so should you want to invest in cover, please take that moment now. Sorry, bad joke, they did. My name is Chris, and this is Adam, and we're here representing Integrated Science Education Outreach, or Inside Out. We are a program that partners with communities around the world to address science education and science literacy. To that end, we have been very successful. In fact, our first partner here in Rochester, Lincoln K-8 Choice School, has been in the top three schools of all of Minnesota with regard to science education for 6 years running. When you take a look at our partner scientists, you can tell right away we're not using a trickle-down philosophy. We are beginning with science from the ground up. And we do want to take a moment here to acknowledge that our first year class of Inside Out in Minnesota included Ahmed Ahmed, the student who was just named Rhodes Scholar from Minnesota. Much of our work requires the use of microscopy, as we see here and even here. K-8 However, we have identified two major problems with microscopy. The microscopes that do the work that we need to see the living models that we use in classrooms cost quite a bit of money. Secondly, once a class has actually acquired these expensive tools, oftentimes they develop a don't-touch philosophy because of either the cumbersome nature of the microscopes or the perceived high cost. Students are directed to put their hands behind their back and not touch the equipment that's been brought to increase their accessibility to science. Adam?
Our microscopes, called Insider's View, has bridged both cost and accessibility for students, hobby level, and professional scientists. This Wi-Fi-enabled microscope has the capability to broadcast on any computer, tablet, or phone through freely available software. Students can work together to capture and share high-resolution images and videos. The base contains an inexpensive light source, an adjustable mirror, which is critical for viewing living materials. Magnification ranges from 20 to 200 times, which is ideal for viewing individual cells, invertebrates, and early development models like zebrafish. The heavy and durable plastic body is sized for all hands, and if ordering classroom sizes and above, we can have the body of the scope molded in your school colors. We have the ability to produce these microscopes by 3D printing, but the 3D printing is too time consuming and cost prohibitive for large production runs. So I am here at Walleye Tank to allow everyone in the audience a first crack at our Kickstarter campaign, which will fund the molds that will allow for high production runs at a reasonable price. Through the Inside Out program, we have already filled pre-orders at 50% of our $110,000 funding goal with investors in Minnesota, Florida, Illinois, and India.
So now I want to welcome you to the pre-Kickstarter kickstart for the Insider's View. For the next 2 days, should you want to take part in our Kickstarter, it will be made available to you for $129 against its $300 actual price. After 48 hours, we will continue with this Kickstarter, and we will increase that cost to $199. For those of you who wish, a pledge of $1,499 will secure a set of 10 Insider's viewers for yourself or for a classroom. And finally, for those of you who want to collaborate with us at a whole new level, we welcome $10,000 to raise toward 70 Insider's viewers and the commitment of our entire scientific team to connect in person or digitally with up to 3 classrooms that you support with the purchase. So we thank you for your time today in joining us. We think this is a fantastic opportunity to come together as a community for science. We envision this as the first of many products that will come out of this space. We are thankful to showcase both Inside Out and this new product. We have room to invite you to both programs. We are unapologetic about our intent to change the world through the work of all of our science partners.
And what will it take to deliver to you an Insider's View today?
Thank you very much. I believe we've got time since Carl has left the room, so we're happy to take 20 minutes of questions.
Try one.
So for the 3D printing, that actually is not cost-effective.
It's mostly time-effective. We can crowdsource that activity, and that is certainly within the realm of concepts that we're looking at. But really, going to a mold eliminates so much of that time caught up in the print of the microscope.
But cost-effective. Do we pennies for the molds, and then the plastic $15.
And at this point, we're outsourcing part of the microscopy unit that we're in the process of trying to replace in time for the Kickstarter. So that is the only limiting factor in that price. All right. Thank you very much.
All right. Next up is now I have a wireless mic. We need the mics back. Did you guys drop them off?
We go to the bathroom.
That's an old reference.
I've actually left a classroom.
So next up we have Brian Carlson with an interesting project that hopefully we will see flower into something great in the Rochester area very soon.
Great. Good afternoon. Is that right? Try that again. Hopefully you can hear that. That's good. Good afternoon, I'm Brian Carlson. This is exciting when we think about new opportunities, not only directly here in southeastern Minnesota, but a number of you that have come down from Minneapolis, St. Paul, and the region to be able to share your technologies with us. Glad to have you here, number one. We are pleased that We're excited that there are quite a number of new developing companies that are not only, again, directly here in southeast Minnesota, but also that are perhaps, for lack of a better term, obligated to go to Minneapolis-St. Paul to find space to be able to develop your new technology. A couple of gentlemen from MinFarm talked about a new facility that just opened up up in the cities that provides wet lab, dry lab, mechanical lab, office spaces at which they're doing their work. We have that same need here. And there are a number of locations that are available in Minneapolis-St. Paul, but nothing directly in the immediate Rochester area. A number of us have gotten together over the last year or so and talked about what are the needs, where should that be, and the fortunate part is we have the ability to have a facility just down the street from us to be able to provide those kinds of spaces, and we don't necessarily have to default to going up to Minneapolis or St. Paul. The current situation that we have worked on is we've been doing some concept planning. We have interviewed a number of folks immediately here in Rochester, some of whom are in the room. Thank you very much for your help. We've prepared a concept plan for how the laboratory spaces would lay out. They are being designed for flexible uses so that as a company starts and continues to grow, you start with a single employee, you may add one or two after 24 months, and before you have the capital capability to go out and build your own new site, maybe you want to push out a wall and have an additional lab space of maybe 1,500 feet or 2,000, or perhaps, as the MinFarm gentleman had talked about, they have to have production space. That's a key for a lot of early stage companies to be able to have those facilities available. We are planning to be able to continue on with the planning of how this will look. And the intent is to be able to have these laboratory spaces available before the end of 2017. You can put any picture on the wall. The picture that you do see up in front of you has come by way of the architects that have helped us do the design through the assistance of interviews of the local folks here in Rochester and the assistance of the folks at University Enterprise Labs in Minneapolis who have said this model works. We think it's very applicable for what you're trying to do in southeastern Minnesota. Let's figure out how we can work collaboratively to make this thing go forward. Final design is not yet determined, however, so the question that we have at the present time is, we need your help. If you are trying to identify current lab needs, if somebody in your network is trying to figure out what their lab needs may be, or perhaps what your upcoming growth might be, we would love to talk to you. There is a facility which is available and we are working to develop right now. It is a 57,000 square foot former medical manufacturing facility just down the road. We have the capability to custom design laboratory and office spaces for anybody that is so inclined. We do also have a couple of folks for contact if you have questions. My name and phone number is listed here. Also at the back of the room, I've got a couple of brief sheets with the same exact slide. We'd certainly be very interested to chat more with you if you or someone else you know has a need for these kinds of spaces right here in Southwest Minnesota. Thanks.
Any questions? One.
A quick question on the cost.
To be determined, the current state that we're in at the present time is we're completing a feasibility study right now to be completed, we anticipate, before the end of March, which will give us the pro forma for the folks who are investing in putting this particular facility together.
At the end of March, we're anticipating being able to say potential lease rates would be in this particular neighborhood. That way, when somebody is looking for particular spaces, you can find out how that fits in with your budgetary plans.
Sort of follow up, are you looking at cost structure?
The question is determining what the cost factors will be, and we have looked at a couple of things. We've looked at cost structures from Chicago to Minneapolis to actually one of our design partners is out of Boston. And one of the things that we're looking at is not only A, from a competitive standpoint, what is it that would be similar to what we would have in the Minneapolis-St. Paul metro area, but quite frankly, what do we need directly here in the Rochester area? Great. Thank you. I will be around and will likely be at Collider as well. If you have additional questions, I'd be more than happy to chat with you at that time. Thanks.
All right. Something tells me you've seen this guy before. So without further ado, let's welcome back Hunter Downs to talk about Area 10 Labs.
Yeah, this is on. So, I mean, you have seen me before. So, I want to introduce myself. I will introduce Area 10 Labs today. We're a company that's actually been around for 13 years. We started in Hawaii 13 years ago. We do basically R&D and prototype development. We used to say we focus on advancing technologies that fuse humans with intelligent computing and communications and sensors. Now we just say this, we do cool things. Area 10 used to be called Argonautics, which is way too hard to say, way too hard to pronounce. So we called it Area 10 because we're both from the neuroscience background, and those of you who know Rodman areas, and you know Area 10 is a prefrontal area that lights up whenever you see something cool. This gives you an idea. I kind of went through my grants and I just said, dump all the keywords in here and see what happens. And we did this word cloud. So if you take like any of the words, chances are we've done a project with that, and you can combine it with another one, we did that, and you can just keep going until you go pass out. We basically do ideas to reality. So if you come to us and you say, hey, I have this need, and here's my concept of how I can do it, we can help you go from there to a prototype to even a company. We've built 10 companies to date. Three companies are large and growing, as I said. We have one in Vancouver and one in San Diego as well. I wanted to give you an idea of the kind of things we do too, the ones I can talk about. So we've done a lot of work for DARPA. This is one of the DARPA projects. This was to take both eye tracking and EEG and be able to identify when somebody saw something of interest, a target, if you will, from images. So we did this also for the Department of Security as well. And the idea was not just to be able to say, oh yeah, he saw something that was interesting, but then take that, extract features from that image, run it through intelligent algorithms, and be able to actually identify those in real time just using algorithms. That same thing would also look at the individual and be able to identify when they were fatigued. This is a project we did last year. It's a wearable that we built from scratch. We did the design, we did everything all the way to manufacturing. It's now in production. It's basically an accelerometer device like a Fitbit, but it also has the ability to wirelessly download or USB download directly and charge from that. So the key features being, of course, that it doesn't need any other charging device or anything else. It also has a strap that has a context sensitive region that will be able to tell when it's on your wrist and when it's off. Any questions?
Next up, we have Xavier Fragola and the Mayo Clinic Business Accelerator.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Hi, everyone.
I want to tell you about the Mayo Clinic Business Accelerator, which is a resource that you all know about. We're here to help you, and we can give you three main things. We can give you space. We can give you space, we can give you support, or we can give you a path to funding. In terms of space, we have two spaces in which you can either come from. We have taken from a guy's idea working on a workstation to a team to 406. We have a conference room, and it's a beautiful place where you can go. Then, as you can see, since 2013, we have had 35 companies that have headquartered in the accelerator. This is very good for, and currently there's 20 of them. And if you're an aspiring entrepreneur, you will get the benefit of a network of about a dozen entrepreneurs that combined have raised about $15 million in the last three years. We can also give you all the support, access to the support you need to start your company, that being access to lawyers, accountants, banks, and others that will help you during those initial phases. We also can provide a path to funding. Through the Rochester Economic Development Fund, we have invested in 11 companies with a total of $1.35 million. Importantly, you don't need to be a Mayo Clinic Business Accelerator company to apply for that funding or receive that funding. And actually, a majority of those six are not. We're located in the Biobusiness building, so in a day like today, you can come from here to there without having to go outside and face the snow. So if you have an idea or you know, work on something, I'd say let's have a coffee. Here's my email. If you also want to stay connected to the entrepreneurial development in Rochester, you can join the newsletter. Other than that, thank you. Questions?
Okay. I've always wanted to say this. Jordan Miller, come on down. You are the next contestant on Bait Shop. And this is, as he gets mic'd up, as we just said, Jordan Miller, the Mayo Department of Surgery Innovation Accelerator.
All right. Thank you very much, Jamie. So I'm here today to talk about the Innovation Accelerator within the Department of Surgery. You say, well, you know, we're not the Mayo Clinic Business Accelerator, but we're going to put in a different function here. And so the overall goal of the Innovation Accelerator is to leverage innovation to solidify Mayo Clinic's position as a destination medical surgery practice, really through accelerated prototyping and testing of devices that address key unmet patient needs. And so our model is pretty straightforward and simple, right? So we engage staff, and that includes allied health staff, and clinical staff, and research staff at Mayo to identify critical unmet needs, right? Identify those solutions with the greatest impact. You know, we've got a little bit of a different model system. Admittedly, Mayo Clinic Ventures will say, well, how big is the return on it? And a lot of times they'll just close the door for you right there. If it's a small population, for us, we say, you know, is it actually a really meaningful question, regardless of the market size? We accelerate development of devices by partnering with external contract research organizations. So we do things very rapidly and with a great deal of quality. And we protect our inventors' rights to intellectual property, so we really don't try to dilute any intellectual property, and we're pretty successful protecting that. And ultimately, we facilitate efforts to commercialize technologies, you know, and so we try to do our best to take the frustration out of innovation within the institution. So, our fundamental process is really to run through 12-week cycles where we identify projects, we meet with the inventors and discuss and refine their idea a little bit with some of our external partners. We send it out to the external contract research organizations, get the product back in under 12 weeks, and if there's still time left and money left, then we evaluate the prototype, iterate on that again, and ultimately just go around in this cycle to improve upon a prototype in a very short period of time. You know, we've done a number of projects so far, and again, these are all very high quality prototypes and functional prototypes that come up at the end. And so really, I would say if you have an idea for an unmet to address an unmet clinical or surgical need, call either myself or call Eric or Ross or send us an email. We'd be happy to talk about it, do whatever we can to accelerate it. We do have some funding to help support our process, so it's not as though you say, well, I've got a great idea, and we say, well, great, give us some money, right? We actually try to do our best to identify ways to get things moving and get things done. So with that, I would be happy to take any questions that you have.
All right, who's doing BioLinks? Vic?
No.
Yeah, you're up.
All right.
So as Will was sort of alluding to earlier on when he said he wants to bring the fervor of the startup community out of New York, we want to sort of facilitate that here. And like he said, right now out east there's that fervor, and out west and in other centers around the country that's happening. We want to really foster that attitude here, and today it's great to see a lot of companies that really embody that. And in Minnesota alone, there's all these great companies right up the road. So there's no reason why, with this precedent set, that we can't continue the tradition of starting great companies from very humble places. And we obviously have lots of brain power. We got lots of physicians, nurses, grad students, that great source of labor for really smart people. They also have ideas too. We want to bring all these people in the room together and spawn some really great things. So we have three actions that we want to perform. We want to connect people, we want to educate them, and we want to create new things together. So by connecting, we offer a bi-weekly meeting. We try to just get people in the room and talk about their ideas, their problems, what they've learned in their process of building things. We have a few people right now that are in that process. They've been a great source of lessons for everybody in the group. And this really helps a lot of people out, just making that connection. It's a huge part of entrepreneurship. We also want to educate, which is we want to connect people with the resources that teach some of the basic tenets. A lot of what we believe in is based on the Lean Startup Method, so we connect people with those basic resources. And we also are starting a seminar series represented by that image. We had our first one earlier this month. We brought in Pat Dillon from Minnesota SBIR to talk about her work, and that was really great. We drew a big crowd. So we want to continue that. There's a lot of things that people need to know about entrepreneurship, and we want to bring in the people that know a whole lot about those things, including sales and legal IP and all these things that, that need to make entrepreneurship and startups go. And we also want to create, just getting these people in the room, talking. New ideas come out all the time. We just brought in a new member last week that was able to spur some great stuff. We got some high schoolers that were helping start this process. It's been really great. So if you'd like to connect with our group, like I said, we have the bi-weekly meetings, and we also are starting the seminar series. If you want to connect with that, you can go to walleyetank.com/biolinks. We have a calendar there. You can email the group. I didn't put up there, but it's biolinks@gmail.com. And I didn't mention them in the earlier slides, but there is also a more medical entrepreneurship focus group that just started by Claudia Gutierrez. They had a great first event, brought in Kathy Bates and another physician. I feel terrible forgetting his name, but they're from Mayo Medical Labs. They had a great first talk. So if you want to get connected to either of those groups, feel free to email us. So thank you very much. We have at the university. No, we haven't really reached out to the university yet.
But we're not at all.
Yeah, that'd be fantastic. Sure. Yeah, bro. Yeah, and I didn't mention also collaborating other people in the area. We want to definitely connect. We really believe in a term I love to use, cross pollination. Right. So that's definitely something we want to do. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, absolutely.
All right. The last speaker,
me.
So I'm just going to give you a brief. I spoke at the first Walleye Tank, and I presented this vision of what we called at that time Collider Core. Since I've adopted the word Collider Co-working to be a little more specific. So if you're not sick of me by now, my name is Jamie Sunsbach, and I'm the community manager of Collider Co-working. So we really want to start with a statement that says we believe that Rochester and the surrounding area can really become a globally recognized location for entrepreneurship and innovation. We believe that very deeply. And we saw several companies here that are Rochester-based or has the roots in Rochester today that really, I think, exemplifies that and really gives us a basis for where we're going to go in the future. So what is Collider Co-working? Well, first and foremost, we're a hub for entrepreneurship and small business. We're industry agnostic. We want to see people from all over start great things, and we want to help them do that. We want to support entrepreneurs from the start. We want to foster what we call random collisions, and that's really where we got the name Collider. We want these random collisions. We want to put people with diverse skill sets in the same room and see what becomes of that. And I think that in the last 4 months that we've been open, we've proven time and time again, almost on a daily basis, that that model works. But we also want to be recognized that so many people come to Rochester for treatment or to do business. And we want to really serve as an outpost for those people and really companies that are not located in Rochester. So for all of you in the Twin Cities, if you need a place to come down, meet, take a desk, get some work done, we're there for you. So this was a concept drawing that I showed way back during the first Walleye Tank. And we really, we weren't done. In fact, I took a couple of you through on a tour of the space. We had to wear hard hats. Well, it is slippery outside, so you may have to wear a hard hat, but if you come to Collider today, what you're going to see is exemplified in a lot of these pictures. So you see a great space to work together. You see that we hold a lot of educational events. This was a movie premiere that we did around UX design. We're also age appropriate. We don't run a daycare, but we have thought of it. But it's a great place for entrepreneurs of all ages to gather. And we hold a lot of great week-long events, such as Global Entrepreneurship Week, we just got over a few weeks ago. I think there's 26 companies that are currently taking a desk in Collider. About a third of these I would class as startups. Another third are sort of more mature companies that just want a space downtown. And the other third are kind of a hodgepodge of different things. But we were really focused on early stage startups at first. And we found that by kind of throwing everybody at all levels into a room, amazing things can happen. So how do we make money? Well, we rent you desks. We sell community memberships. We have drop-in rates. Standard stuff. If you're familiar with COCO in the Twin Cities, it's a very similar model. We're working on other things such as educational events and stuff coming in 2017, which we think will be of great benefit to the community as well. So the team, we have a great team, myself, Amanda, who's in the back there. She's an entrepreneur herself. She runs Rochester Rising, which is a fantastic blog that highlights the Rochester and the surrounding area, all of the entrepreneurial activity that's happening. She has a great podcast and really has been sort of the Mike Wallace, that's going to date me a little bit, of the entrepreneurial world here in Rochester. And then Preston, who is probably, I would say, has been the biggest help to me in the last 4 months getting started with Collider. He volunteers his time to help out. He's been an intern with companies such as Techstars, he has a tremendous knowledge base about startups, and he's working on one of his own. So I think that's great. So this is Collider. You can contact us. All our contact information and social is there. Or give us a call, and hopefully you follow us back through the snowdrifts. And don't get lost, and we can have a great event just shortly later. A couple of notes. We also have many community events and resources. The first one I'm going to talk about is brand new. In fact, we haven't talked about this at all, really. And that's our creative directory. So if you go to collider.min/creative-directory, you can sign yourself up. It's very easy in one click. And you can sort of designate some of these terms to really describe who you are in the community. And we do this because a lot of you are looking for things like development help, front end, back end. You're looking for project management, even arts and photography. Well, we wanted to create one space for you to go, click, and actually see a list of people you can reach out to directly. So we think that the only way this is going to be effective is if we use it, so we highly encourage you all to go on and sign up. Second of all, we'll be holding our second TEDx here in Rochester on Thursday, May 18th, 2017 at Autumn Ridge Church. This is an amazing event, the first year. Really blew my mind, and really, I think, in a lot of ways, the feedback I'm hearing put Rochester on the map as a really innovative space that, you know, people knew about for medical but didn't know the tremendous amount of talent we have in our community. And last but not least, 1 Million Cups will be launching February of 2017. This has been a passion project of mine for the last 3 years. So if you're a company and you want to actually present at 1 Million Cups Rochester, check out the link below and sign up. The website's a little kludgy right now. I'm building it as we speak. But definitely the apply to present is ready to go, and we encourage you to apply. So with that, thank you, and we'll turn it back over to you.
Thanks, Jamie.
Thanks, Jamie and everybody. I think that I want to pass a couple of comments on. I want to thank Jake Bergren and Alex Cook, because they really made a lot of this happen. So let's give them a round of applause. They're part of a Mayo grad program, so they graduated, and then this has been part of their adventure at Mayo Clinic this year. So I hope they're having a good time. We certainly had a great time having them. I just wanted to, Carl, you can come on down. Carl's gonna actually has the outcome. I just wanted to tell you it was hilarious because I was just a witness to the deliberations, is that the walleyes had a really hard time trying to get down to even just, you know, five, right? Just trying to get the five results. So it was very active, and just want to get to everybody positive deliberation, because I think we have terrific ideas being pitched here, terrific entrepreneurs, wonderful processes, innovative business models, all being presented today. So that was sort of the point, right? The point is to be able to do that and grow. So with that, I'm going to give it to Carl, where he can tell us the winners.
All right. So yes, after lots of discussion, we have sort of come up with a consensus of what the different category winners are. And one of the things that we talk about as a challenge, at least at Walleye Tank, is we're still kind of beginning, and we have lots of these, you know, we're calling them the professional talks, but there's a huge range of where they are in companies, and so that's one of the challenges the walleyes deal with, is how are we judging this? And we hope that as Walleye Tank continues to grow, we can split that out and make that easier for the walleyes, because I don't want to have to wrangle them like I wrangled you with talking, like I did today. So here we came down with some answers. So for the junior angler division, we have winner, drum roll, C2 Solutions. Who can be left?
My dad.
Are they here? We gotta come down.
My dad.
So the origin of this prize is you are trying to catch a really big walleye. You don't want to catch small walleye.
You want to catch a big walleye. So to catch a big walleye, you need what? You need a lure. So we're not just giving you a lure, we're giving you the largest lure available. It's 9 inches. So hopefully that will get you to the next round of finances.
All right, and we had lots of great presentations today, and I think if you have a chance to stick around and talk with the walleyes, they had lots of comments that I'm sure they're now willing to share with you if you're able to come over to Collider. Hopefully, a lot of the walleyes will be there. I didn't ask them who's going on. So our second place prize winner today is Jeanette Akir.
That is the largest walleye available on Amazon. Okay, so there you go.
Congratulations. It's a cribbage set, too.
It's a cribbage set.
Very Midwest.
Very Midwest. Okay, awesome.
All right, and the first place winner of today's Walleye Tank Pitch presentation is Cover.
While they come down, there's a story behind this prize. I wanted the prize to be developed by a Minnesota artist. And through a very long story involved eBay and shipping, we actually have a prize made from Walker, Minnesota. So it is a genuine certified Minnesota walleye. Let me pull it out. Hold on.
I think he needs two hands. It's a big fish.
We are also a learning institution, so Walleye Tank was an experiment in June. We got enough positive feedback to do it again in December. I encourage you to contact any one of us if you have suggestions for how to improve what we're doing. We want to continue to grow and be successful, so please do that. The rest of it, I just want to, in the back of your program is the map to Collider for those that are going to Collider, and we will have some escorts there. Otherwise, I just want to thank everybody. I want to thank you for the audience participation. I want to thank the walleyes for the great questions. I really want to thank the presenters. You did a fantastic job. I learned a lot in all aspects of your presentations. And we will do this again next year, and we will post that information through Walleye Tank and other communications. So thank you very much. Thanks for your time.
Congratulations.